Okay, everyone ready? Will you sing with me, standing in unison?
I'm Roused Hour. Zap Roused Hour.
Roused Hour. Roused Hour.
Greetings and welcome to On Hold with Atchka. I'm the proprietor of Atchka, Shannon, and I would just like to apologize up front to all of our Canadian brethren and sister and for using it as a pretense to showcase some of the finer Canadian cultural contributions to Western, you know, stuff. I respect Canada deeply. I respect their traditions and their cultures and their funny little hats. I think they are an incredible source of humor for us. You know, and they provide us with the kind of moral superiority that America really needs. You know, in this day when everything is going to shit for us, you know, we can always look up and say, well, at least we're not Canada. And that really holds out a lot of hope for most Americans. So I just want to apologize if any of that offends you, because the interview today is actually quite serious. And for those of you who are confused by the melding of humor and serious topics, I just would like to warn you, I guess, that this will be the template for Atchka on hold, that just because we're going to be discussing serious topics does not mean that we leave our funny bones at the door, because that would hurt to remove those, and I would rather not ask you to remove yours, and I'd certainly not ask you to remove mine. So in these little introductions and commercials that we'll have, there will be humor, and during the interviews themselves there will not be humor, unless of course something funny is said, and then in which case I may have to post some kind of warning that humor is contained within the interview as well. So brace yourselves for that. And as way of another more serious warning, the discussion that takes place between Dr. Sharma and I does discuss some topics that may have triggers for certain people. We discuss bariatric surgery and dieting. If you're sensitive to those things, please don't listen. Otherwise, I hope you enjoy the interview.
This is On Hold with Atchka. Arya Sharma, professor of medicine and chair of obesity research and management at the University of Alberta. He's also medical director of the Alberta Health Services Interdisciplinary Weightwise Program. And he's scientific director of the Canadian Obesity Network, which is funded through the National Centers of Excellence Program. Now, you've come to my attention through some articles that I've recently read where you have called on physicians to stop recommending to patients that obese patients lose weight in order to treat obesity, and instead to maintain their weight through you know, health and exercise. Why this shift in attitude? You know, the traditional route is lose weight. That's the only way to treat obesity. What? How did you come to this conclusion that it's just not working? It's counterproductive.
It's counterproductive for most people, because the usual experience for people who try to lose weight is that you lose weight and sooner or later the weight comes back. And so when you go out and just tell people to lose weight, what they often do is they'll go out, they'll try on their own, they might join some commercial weight loss program, they'll get the weight off, and usually you'll find that after 3 to 6 months they're doing well because they've lost the weight. But when you see the same person again after a year or after 2 years, very often they put all of the weight back on, and they're just and their frustration and self-esteem is just blown away by going through these repeated cycles. And so I think what health professionals have to do in general is to accept the fact that treating obesity is difficult. Losing weight is one thing, but keeping it off is really what we're after. And unfortunately, right now, there aren't many people out there who are successful in managing their weight loss in the long term, and most people fail to do so without professional help.
And how widespread is this new message of let's maintain the weight, let's not encourage people to lose it? How are you one of the few people that are doing it, or is the message getting spread further throughout the healthcare industry?
Well, I think people have been thinking about the concept for a long time. There is, for example, the health at any size movement that's been out there for a while that has always been saying, you know, you should just try to be as healthy as possible at any weight, because running after weight loss and then just putting it back on again is probably not good for you. So the message has been out there, but I don't think that this is the mainstream message that has been embraced by a lot of health professionals. And to be very clear, I'm not saying that weight loss, if you can lose the weight and keep it off, does not have its benefits. There's absolutely no question that that is the case. And we know that, for example, from all the bariatric surgery studies where people have bariatric surgery, lose weight, and then have this very remarkable improvement in health because their blood pressure normalizes, they come off their sleep apnea machines, their diabetes is just, you know, just melts away or disappears, their quality of life gets so much better. So there's no question that if your excess weight is affecting your health, what you want to do is lose weight and keep it off. But this is not achieved in clinical practice by just telling people to go and lose weight. If you think your patient needs to lose weight, then you better make sure you're providing the right advice, the right support, and the right treatments that are going to make it likely that your patient is actually going to succeed. Just telling them to eat less, or just telling them to go out and exercise, or just telling them, listen, you need to lose weight, is not effective treatment.
Now, you brought up bariatric surgery. And there are people who, you know, agree and disagree with the need for bariatric surgery. Now, one way I've heard it described is that bariatric surgery takes a healthy digestive system and makes it diseased. It causes it to be diseased. And this is
there's another version of looking at that, and that is says that bariatric surgery is modernizing your gut. Okay. You know, we all have a 2-liter stomach that was designed for eating when food was there. And that, at the time when the stomach was, you know, evolved, was not always the case on a daily basis. And so it's a huge advantage that when you don't have a steady food supply system, that you better have a 2-liter stomach that you can fill up when there's food, or when food is around. And we also have a, you know, 7 meters of intestines, which were designed to digest food that was hard to digest, so stuff. You know, if you were eating off a diet of roots and berries and tough meat, well, you better have those 7 meters of intestine to make sure you extract every last piece of nutrient from that food. Now, unfortunately, that is no longer the way that we eat. We are surrounded by food, so that really we don't need a 2-liter stomach anymore, nor do we need 7 meters of gut, because the food that we eat today is so highly processed that a few centimeters of gut are virtually enough to extract all the nutrients that are in there. So I've heard this, you know, described as actually, you know, surgically modernizing the gut rather than, because you're just doing away with pieces that you don't need. Now, is that the best approach? Certainly not. I mean, it would be much better if you could change the environment, and if you could make better foods available, and if you could not be surrounded by food all the time. But is that going to happen anytime soon? Probably not. So it's not about arguing whether surgery is the right approach or the wrong approach at a societal level. You know, I'm a physician. I treat individuals. And when I have a patient in front of me and I see that their life is being destroyed by their excess weight, their health is being destroyed by their excess weight, they've tried every diet in the book, they've lost their entire weight over and over again just to put it back on. And I know the results from long-term studies in bariatric surgery, where we now have data that has followed these patients for 15 and 20 years, where we see these remarkable successes. I mean, it's my job as a clinician then to tell patients, listen, you have an option. Whether you like it or not, here's something that, you know, may work for you and which I've seen work for other people and which is something you might consider. Now, having said that, I'm not a surgeon. I don't operate on people. I send my patients to surgeons so that they can get operated on if I think that the operation is the best solution for that patient. So it's not about being for or against surgery. It's about making sure that the right people get surgery at the right time. And I always tell my patients, surgery is not a quick fix. If you want surgery to work for you, you've got to look at this as a tool. You're probably going to have to make a lot of lifestyle changes. Some of them might be easier because of the surgery. So you're not hungry all the time, and you're not, and there's a limit to the amount of food you can eat. That makes it easier. But there's a lot of things that make it more difficult to live with surgery. But the bottom line is more people do better with surgery than without, especially if you're talking severe obesity.
Right. And a lot of the patients that you see, you know, and that you would recommend to it, how do you ensure that, you know, that person is psychologically ready to handle? I mean, because it's not just you making a lifestyle choice. You're having this, you know, once you have the surgery, the lifestyle choice is no longer a choice. You have to change.
You know, that's a great question. It's so important to really find out what the motivation is. Does your patient understand what they're getting into? Are they capable of making the changes that they need to make in order to be successful with surgery? Surgery is not something that you take lightly. It's not the easy way out. It's not a quick fix. It's not something that you can just have and that's going to solve all your problems. It's something that you really have to work at to make this work. Remember, I mean, you know, it works for a lot of people, but there's a lot of people who have surgery and they're unhappy. It doesn't work for them. They put the weight, they lose some weight, they put it back on. They get depressed. Their relationships break up. They look at them. You know, they look in the mirror every morning and don't see themselves. It's not something that you can just get and live happily ever after. Surgery is not for everyone.
Okay. Now, I'd like to ask you about the Edmonton obesity staging system. I've been impressed by it. I think it's definitely a marked change from how we've been dealing with obesity. My question is, you know, I've had people ask me and to ask you, what about people who are, you know, metabolically healthy, but have other health issues that aren't related to obesity? How do they fit in? I mean, or does it not come into, if it's not an obesity-related or correlated issue, does it not come into play with the EOSS?
Yeah, it's a great question because when you look at the Edmonton obesity staging system, it's based on whether or not you have problems that are related to your excess weight. Now, there are some conditions that are directly caused by your excess weight. So, for example, if you gain weight, you get type 2 diabetes, you lose the weight, the diabetes goes away. The same is for sleep apnea, right? You put on the weight, you get sleep apnea, you lose the weight, sleep apnea goes away. That's straightforward. So those are conditions that are essentially caused by obesity. You treat obesity, you're treating the cause, obesity goes away, the condition gets better. So that's easy. But then there's, as you say, there's a number of conditions that are not really caused by obesity. So let's take, for example, emphysema. So somebody's got emphysema because they smoked 20 years or whatever, right? But now their breathing gets worse because of their size. So being large is making it more difficult for them to actually breathe properly. And losing weight is going to make the breathing better. Is losing weight going to reverse their emphysema? Obviously not. I mean, they'll still have emphysema, but because they're now no longer, you know, carrying around that extra weight, it becomes easier for them to breathe. So you have these conditions where I would say they're aggravated by excess weight, but they're not actually caused by excess weight. And there also you have benefits of weight loss. So the first question that you're always going to ask in a patient who presents with any question, with any health problem is this health problem directly related to their excess weight, and do you expect this to get better if they actually lost weight? Now, there are lots of problems out there that don't get better when you lose weight, and so weight loss is not what you recommend for these patients. But there are numerous problems that do get better with weight loss, and therefore, if you decide that, you know, this patient is actually going to have very significant health benefits from losing that weight, well, then it's not enough to say, go out and lose the weight. Then you really have to take the next step and say, okay, here's the evidence-based treatment. This is what it's going to take. It's a long-term process. It's one thing to lose the weight, but it's a completely different story trying to keep that weight off, and this is where you're going to need professional help in the long term and not just for a little while.
Now you've said that you know, the staging system is to determine, you know, how the weight is affecting your health, whether it's causing or aggravating it, and that it determines whether you should recommend to the patient that they should try to lose weight. But apart from, you know, the bariatric surgery, which, you know, can still result in weight regain, you've admitted as much that there is no way to affect long-term weight loss. So how I'm kind of confused as to what...
Okay, so I wouldn't say there's no way. There are a lot of people out there who have lost weight and are keeping it off. Mm-hmm. When you go to the weight control registry, I mean, there's thousands of people out there who've lost weight and are keeping it off. So it's not something that's impossible to achieve. It's just very difficult to achieve. And it's all the more difficult to achieve if you're looking for a quick fix and if you say, you know what, I'll go on this diet for 6 weeks just to get the pounds off and then you know, somehow magically they'll stay off, which interestingly is what most patients believe, right? They come and they say, you know, if I could only lose the first 40 pounds, then the next 40 pounds are going to come off. Mm-hmm. That's not the way this works. And in fact, sometimes the things that you may have to do to get the 40 pounds off may not be the kind of things that are sustainable. So I always tell my patients, the first thing we want to do is make sure this is as heavy as you're going to get, ever. Right, so this is we're going to stop the weight. You've been gaining, you know, 2 pounds, 3 pounds, 5 pounds, 10 pounds every year for the last 10 years. Let's make sure that stops. So let's focus on preventing further weight gain. We don't want you to get any heavier, because if you get heavier, you're going to have problems. So that's our first goal. If you can achieve that for a lot of patients, that is very successful. And I always say, you know, if you walk into my office today, you're 300 pounds. You walk out of my office in 10 years from now, you're still only 300 pounds. I've probably done a fantastic job. Right? So let's focus on preventing weight gain first. Now, for some people, that's not enough. Because let's do more. So now let's look at, see, well, what more can you do? Are you going to be exercising 3 hours a day for the rest of your life? Probably not. Could you do an hour of exercise? Yeah, maybe. How much weight loss is that going to give you? 60 pounds? Probably not. Maybe 10? Okay. So let's do that. And let's see if you can do that. But I can tell you right away, when you lose those 10 pounds, you're going to have to continue exercising an hour a day to keep those 10 pounds off. You can't just exercise now and get the pounds off and then stop the exercise, because I promise you the weight is coming back. And we can do the same for dieting. I mean, you can, one of the best proven methods for controlling your weight is writing down what you eat. It's called self-monitoring, and every successful weight management program recommends that you keep a food diary. Okay, so if that works for you, do you see yourself keeping that food diary now from now on forever? Because I can tell you that the day you stop keeping that food diary, your weight's probably coming back. So the deal now is we've got to find something that you can do and that you can stick with, and that's not too much of a chore, and that fits your lifestyle and fits what you need, that you can just do forever. And if that results in some weight loss, then the weight loss you'll get there may not be the amount of weight you want to lose, which could be, 40% of your body weight? That's not going to happen. But it might be 5%, it might be 10%, and the good news is that for many obesity-related health conditions, a 5% weight loss or even a 10% weight loss can have very remarkable effects. So you don't need to lose 20% of your body weight for health benefits. And that's the message that you really need to hammer home, and you have to keep reminding people, this is not a competition with anybody. This is trying to get the best weight that you can possibly achieve and still have a life that's worth living. You know, that's fun, but you can still do things that you enjoy, and it's because otherwise you're not going to stick with it, and if you don't stick with it, weight's just going to come back.
Okay, I hope you've enjoyed the first half of On Hold with Atchka, our interview with Dr. Arya Sharma, leading bariatric internist from Canada. And I'd just like to take a moment and offer the following public service announcement in defense of Canada. We'll offer some of the finer points of Canadian culture, or Canadiacana, as they call it.
And then the drunk guy says, I can't help being an idiot. I'm Canadian.
You're right. They're so pathetic, Mike.
Huh? Enough. There's been too much Canada bashing for far too long. I say no more.
Don't you mean no more, eh?
Good one, man. They are so stupid.
Stop it now. Instead, let us offer our northern brothers and sisters this song of tribute. Oh, I wish I was back in old Canada, a land which I never shall lampoon. How I pine for the ice covering Lake Manitoba and the beauty that is Saskatoon.
I got one.
Oh, I wish I was stuck in the hills of Alberta, drinking beer with some big dumb guy trapping fur. Hey. As he scraped and he chiseled all the moose dung off his boots, I would learn that he's the prime minister.
Oh, stop that.
Oh, I wish I was in the land that gave us Peter Jennings, Alanis Morissette, Mike Myers, too.
Yeah.
No, I take that back. I wouldn't go there even if you paid me. Oh, Canada, you are a place I must eschew.
Now, this is not in the spirit that I intended.
Oh, come on, give in. I mean, after all, they gave us Ed the Sock and Rush.
Yeah, what are you defending? They're such thieves.
Okay, I'll try.
All right, good man.
Oh, I wish I was blowing up Prince Edward Island and going on to bomb Ontario. The destruction of Canada and all of love its culture. It's by far my favorite scenario.
Okay, I mean, that's a little strong.
No, no, you were right, Mike. This is much more fun. Just where the hell does Canada get off sharing a border with countries far superior to it?
Yikes.
Why, you lousy, stinking, francophonic, bacon-loving bastards. Your country's just a giant piece of...
Whoa, I think that's enough. I think we're going to jam out. Okay, thanks. All right.
Sorry. I have no sense of proportion. I'm a disgrace to my uniform.
No, that's okay. Now, calm down. Now, we mustn't hate.
At least so overtly.
Exactly right. Must disguise our hate just a little. Okay, yeah. We'll be right back. Shh. It's okay now, Dudley.
Pardonnez-moi.
There's a landmark study done by the Cooper Institute by epidemiologist Stephen Blair. And he found that the best predictor for mortality was cardiovascular fitness, independent of body weight, BMI, or percentage of body fat. And that's something that I keep coming back to again and again. I keep seeing that cardiovascular fitness, how active you are, is really the key to health, rather than your weight, your size, your diet. Although those do have, you know, obviously they do affect it. But my question is, why use something like the Edmonton obesity staging system, which focuses more on BMI, and not move to something that focuses more on a patient's cardiovascular health?
Well, the Edmonton obesity staging system doesn't focus on BMI. It focuses, BMI tells you how big you are.
Right.
The Edmonton staging system tells you how sick you are. Uh-huh. And those are very important distinctions, because when you come to me as a doctor and you're looking for medical help, my job is, I don't really worry about how big you are. All that I'm interested in is finding out how sick you are and trying to determine whether your excess weight is part of the problem, and if it is, then that's something we need to address. Now, Stephen Blair, who's actually a good, you know, friend and colleague of mine, always hammers home the message, and I totally agree, that if you're not, that for most people within, you know, a reasonable BMI range, it's probably more important to be fit than to be less fat. Mm-hmm. Now, this may not apply to somebody whose BMI is 50, who's got reflux disease, who's got sleep apnea, whose back is killing him, who's going to be sitting in a wheelchair soon because of their osteoarthritis and can't find a surgeon to operate on their knees because of their size. This person, A, doesn't have a chance to be fit, and B, there's no question that this person is going to need some very serious obesity treatment. So within a reasonable range of BMI, when we're talking BMIs, you know, 25, 30, maybe even 35, if you eat well and you're healthy and you're moving around and you're exercising, then you may actually be a lot better off than someone who's, you know, a skinny BMI 21 who's not exercising and who's not physically fit. But when your excess weight starts affecting your health, which means when in the Edmonton obesity staging system you start moving into the twos and threes and obviously the fours, you better find some help to help treat your obesity, because that's going to kill you.
Okay. Now, you're dealing mostly from the obesity side, but I'm curious, what about the other areas in which treatment needs to be made? For instance, on the social determinants of mortality risk, you know, there's a strong correlation between poverty and low birth weight and coronary heart disease, and likewise, there's a strong correlation between poor education and coronary heart disease, and obviously there's another correlation between poverty and obesity. So can we really make a dent in the obesity situation without addressing the social determinants?
Well, you know, it's interesting that you asked that question, because last month there was a report by the OECD and the WHO that actually asked exactly this question, looked at all the things that we know about the social determinants of obesity, very much recognizing, as you've just said, that the reason that we have an epidemic is not because people's genes have suddenly changed overnight. It's really because our living circumstances have changed. And all the factors that you mentioned, poverty, lower socioeconomic class, not having enough time, single-parent families, all those issues are important and need to be addressed. But what the report also tells you is that those are not things you're going to be addressing overnight. So while we need to start making those changes, they are not going to happen overnight. So don't hold your breath for obesity prevention to suddenly start helping people melt those pounds away. Moving society into that direction, to really address issues like poverty, access to healthy foods, reintroducing, you know, phys ed programs into schools, making sure that when kids come home in the afternoon, there's actually somebody there who puts a hot meat on the meal on the table, and make sure they don't spend all afternoon sitting in front of the TV. I mean, those are all changes that are going to take very, very substantial changes in how we run our societies and how we run our lives. Are those changes possible? I don't know. Are we going to see them happening anytime soon? Most likely not. So while we recognize that all of this is important, I think the major consequence that comes out of all of this for me is don't blame people for their weight, because you can't look at somebody and based on their size immediately jump to conclusions about their lifestyle. I've got a lot of patients in my clinic who are large, who are obese, who know more about nutrition, know more about healthy living, and are actually practicing those principles than some of my thinner patients who come in and have other problems. So I think, you know, the bias and discrimination where we say people are fat because they make poor choices and it's essentially their fault and it's nobody else's problem is unfair to them, and it's just a reflection of the, you know, the widespread weight bias and discrimination that obese people face every day in their lives, because everybody thinks, well, these must be stupid people because they're not smart enough to be thin. When that, as you've just said, is not really the case. It is actually very, very difficult not to be fat when you live in our society today.
Okay. Now, jumping right off of that, I'd like to mention an anecdote. When I was a kid, we'd go to the Science Center here in St. Louis, and they'd have a display where you could kind of guess where man would be heading evolutionarily speaking, various things like fertility, height, weight, things like that. And I was always surprised that weight, they said that evolutionarily speaking, we were heading towards a heavier culture, that, you know, because of our sedentary lifestyle. So how would you respond to that? How would you, I've always thought of it as an evolutionary change of you know, the human population, that we would be bigger. Is that something that could possibly be happening, that we're adapting to this affluent culture?
Well, you know, evolution happens in much, much longer time circles, right, or time period. So our genes have not changed. We have not evolved in the last 20 years to be obese. We've been carrying the genes that allow us to become obese forever, and it's not just humans who have this. Look at zoo animals. Look at your pets, your household pets. They all have the genes to become obese because that's what you want. When you live out there in nature and you don't know where your next meal is coming from, you better be able to eat as much as possible when food's around, and you need to be able to conserve and store that extra energy for times when you need it. And so we have a very complicated biological system that allows us to do just that. And that's worked that's worked fine in the past. And it's worked for all our pets in the past, and it's worked for the zoo animals when they live out there in the wild and don't know where their next catch is coming from. But when you take zoo animals or your household pets or ourselves and put them in an environment where there's a constant supply of food and there's no need to really be physically active anymore, then we start putting on weight. And so we've always had that capacity. It's not that our genes have now suddenly changed in the last 20 or 30 or 100 years that allows us to become fat. You can take our Stone Age ancestors and move them to modern times, and they'll put on weight. So we've always had that capacity, and that's what you're seeing. So it's not an evolutionary change that's happening. What has really changed are the circumstances under which we live.
But is it something that we as a species will be adapting to?
Well, I don't think we'll adapt to it, because a lot of the changes that do happen with excess weight, if you're talking about natural selection, they usually manifest themselves after you've already, you know, had your kids, mm-hmm. right? So even if you start getting, you know, blood pressure problems and health problems by the time you're 35 and 40, well, you've probably had your kids by that time, and you've passed your genes on to the next generation already. So the selection pressure of obesity may not be as strong, or certainly not strong enough to start making, you know, any evolutionary changes here in the next couple of generations. Now, may this happen over the next thousands of years? I have no idea. But evolution does not work that fast.
Okay. And I've got one last question for you, and then we're about to the half-hour mark here. And it's somewhat, I wouldn't say controversial, but it's still up in the air, I think. But why label obesity a disease? In that, it doesn't show the consistency that diseases should. Why label it a disease?
Well, probably for the same reason that you label high blood pressure a disease, or high cholesterol a disease, or diabetes a disease, or osteoporosis a disease. It's something that affects your health. Mm-hmm. Now, is the BMI the right definition of disease? I don't know, because we've talked about this. We've said that, you know, when someone, just because you have a high BMI doesn't mean you're sick, right? But if you have excess weight that's affecting your health, well, that's like having high blood pressure that's affecting your health, or having a high cholesterol level that's going to cause a heart attack, or having diabetes that's going to make you go blind or get or ruin your kidneys. So it's when excess weight starts affecting your health that you're now dealing with a disease state that needs to be addressed. It's not about, and you can't just calculate someone's BMI and say, you know what, BMI 29, you're healthy, you're good to go. BMI 30, you're now sick and need to see a doctor. That's where BMI is not helpful. But there's no question that once you have excess weight that's affecting your health, it becomes like a disease, and probably not just a disease, it becomes a chronic disease, because as we've discussed before, it's not a one-time treatment that's going to cure this. Once you have those extra pounds, losing them and keeping them off, you know, is hard work and requires long-term strategies.
But at the same time, you're saying that, you know, it's not obesity itself that's the disease. It's whether obesity causes these other complications. So something like high blood pressure, that wouldn't that always be a disease? I mean, there's not like a time at which high blood pressure would be an okay thing to have, or that there wouldn't be any risks associated with it. Same thing with diabetes. Whereas obesity, you're kind of quantifying it.
Well, actually, there are statistical risks. Not everybody who has high blood pressure is going to end up getting a heart attack or a stroke. Their risk for having a heart attack and a stroke goes up. The same is for diabetes. Not everybody who has diabetes is going to go blind and get a heart attack and lose their limbs. But your statistical chances for that happening go up when you become diabetic. And the same, you know, applies to excess weight. So if I took 100 people off the street and who have excess weight, their chances of ending up with a health problem is higher than if I take 100 skinny people off the street, right? Now, the skinny people might end up getting other health problems, but statistically, once you get to a BMI of 35 and 40, your statistical chances are going to be higher that you're going to have some weight-related problem. And that's the same for blood pressure, and that's the same for high cholesterol. Not everybody who has high cholesterol levels is going to die of a heart attack, but your chances of getting a heart attack go up. And so there really is no difference in how looking at it. Now, we could say that, you know, high cholesterol, diabetes, none of those are diseases. They're all risk factors, and you don't have a disease till you actually have a problem as a consequence. And that's okay. You know, I can live with that. But that's just semantics. That's just how you define these things. In the end, the bottom line is excess weight can affect your health. If it is affecting your health, you better do something about it, because if you don't and you keep gaining weight, you know, your health is just going to deteriorate and it's going to get worse. Is that easy to do? That's a different question, and we've got to talk about treatment options. But there's no question that once your excess weight starts affecting your health, you're now going to need some professional help here.
You've said that you know, not everybody will who is obese will have the risks. Well, isn't the risk more from the sedentary lifestyle then, and not the obesity? So wouldn't the sedentary lifestyle be the disease almost more than the obesity?
It depends on the risk that you're looking at, right? Some of the obesity-related conditions, if you're just thinking heart attacks and diabetes, you know, being physically active is, you know, may help prevent that. And in fact, even certain cancers that may be related to excess weight are less likely if you're also physically fit. But once you get to a certain size, there are just mechanical consequences of being large. You know, if you've got all this extra weight and fat, you know, pressing on your lungs and pressing on your upper abdomen, you know, that's going to make breathing difficult. That's causing reflux disease. That's causing urinary incontinence. Those don't get better by being fitter. But that's just a mechanical consequence of having that extra weight. Now, how much extra weight is it going to take to get those problems? That varies, right? Some people put on 5 pounds, they get a problem. Some people put on 50 pounds, they get a problem. And that's where the Edmonton Obesity Staging System comes in, because it allows you to classify or stage the level of health problems that somebody has as a consequence of their excess weight, and doesn't just blindly follow, you know, some BMI number that's pretty arbitrary.
Okay. Well, you know, I've got more questions I would love to ask, but our time is up, and I greatly appreciate your time. It's been an honor and a pleasure to speak with you. And I look forward to, I want to direct people to your websites, Dr. Sharma, Dr. Sharma, at CA, and, or, I'm sorry, .ca, and I appreciate your time, and I wish you luck, and I look forward to hearing more of your research and theories.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Sharma.
Bye now.
Goodbye.
So, like, take off to the great white north.
Beauty.
Take off. It's a beauty way to go. Take off, you hosers.